86 Charles is brought to you by Amazon. Go to 86charles.com and click on the Amazon link. Amazon is the perfect place to start prepping for the end, now that the Donald is president. The apocalypse is nigh.
The inspiration for the human-plant fusion came over lunch, and the leafy greens were involved when WPI bioengineers began to brainstorm new ways to tackle a deadly medical problem, the lack of donor organs. Of more than 100,000 people on the donor list, nearly 24 people die each day while waiting for an organ transplant. To meet the demand, scientists have tried to create artificial organs through innovations such as 3D printing tissue. So far, however, no one has been able to print a perfect heart.
I will sue you for everything you have. I will sue your ass.
Welcome to 86 Charles, with your hosts John Darby and Travis Spencer.
And with that, welcome to 86 Charles. Travis Spencer, welcome back.
John, I'm falling asleep over here waiting for you to tell me what this means about spinach. You just read some article that didn't say anything. What are you saying?
Well, what I'm saying is what they're trying to do is create heart tissue using spinach. So I'll tell you what, I'll read you a little bit more and then maybe you'll understand what happened.
All right, let's hear it.
So one of the big problems in engineering heart muscle is getting blood flow to all of the cells. Rather than creating minuscule blood vessels, the scientists decided to borrow from what nature already evolved. First, they removed the cells from spinach leaves purchased at a local market. Left behind was cellulose, a plant material known to be compatible with mammal tissue, as well as the intact leaf veins. The scientists seeded the now vacated cellulose matrix with cardiac muscle cells. After 5 days, the muscle cells began to beat. It was not quite as if researchers grew an entire slab of quivering muscle from spinach, and though the scientists watched red liquid course through the spinach veins, this was dye, not blood. But to witness individual human cells contracting on a spinach leaf via microscope was exciting enough. This was not the only instance in which researchers cultivated human tissue on a plant scaffold. Recently, a team of Ottawa scientists stripped an apple of its plant cells, carved a fruit slice to look like a human ear, and filled its extracellular matrix with cervical tissue. So
wow,
it's the very, very beginning of possibly recreating heart tissue using spinach leaves or things of that nature.
This is great stuff, John. You know it's great. Everything's amazing about this, but I have one big question.
Shoot.
We know that spinach and apples are like very fragile, tiny plants compared to marijuana, my friend. Like, this is a very coarse, very awesome, very energetic, very, I don't even know the words to put towards the cannabis plant. Like, look at the veins in a leaf of marijuana compared to the veins against a spinach plant. This is the problem with what we've got going on right now. If we could even study the marijuana plant, that it is not a Schedule I substance in America, my friend, we would know that you could probably just put a good fat indica bud in somebody's heart and it would just like substitute automatically.
You're such a fool.
Am I a fool? You know I'm right. You know I'm 100% right.
Can I add one thing on here since you brought up using the cannabis plant?
Please do.
Even though I don't think it would work in this particular case. But possibly to your point, maybe it could be used in some capacity like this. And they say one advantage of working with plants was the cornucopia of options at the scientist's disposal. In the new report, the biomedical engineers successfully stripped plant cells from parsley, peanut hairy roots, and a species of wormwood in addition to spinach. The biomedical engineers imagined that a piece of broccoli or cauliflower, once stripped of its cells, could be a foundation for growing lung tissue. and researchers in Wisconsin collaborating with the WPI lab recently strolled through their campus arboretum plucking exotic leaves to test.
What did I just say? This is exactly what I just fucking said. Like, literally, to the word, like, you're talking about a complex organism that literally changes your mental, it changes your consciousness. So, on that level, no, hear me out.
That is exactly what I said.
It is.
Like, except for this was very well phrased.
Okay.
And
we're talking
steeped in logic and research, not just put an indica bud in somebody's heart and watch it fix it.
Please connect the fucking dots, John Derby. Look how simple a spinach plant is. Have you ever watched spinach grow? Like, kale is way more complex. And kale is like the same kind of plant that Brussels sprouts and cabbage grow from. Okay, so
Hold on.
More and more complex.
Relax.
And then you get to pot.
Let me ask you a question real quick.
I'm going to sit back just for a second. I'll smoke a bowl while you do this.
Let me ask you a question real quick. Have you seen heart tissue under a microscope?
Yeah, of course I have. No, of course I've not.
Right. So when you ask me if I've seen spinach grow, I have to ask you if you've seen heart tissue under a microscope, because maybe they are the exact same thing. Maybe that's
right,
why.
So we're trying to match.
These guys sitting around talking about stuff at work is a lot different than you and I doing it. So when they see a spinach leaf, they probably are like, hey, this looks pretty similar to heart tissue. And that's where that conversation starts. I'm sure they eat kale, but it probably doesn't resemble.
John, here, yes. I'm going to be your shaman.
Oh,
I'm
going to
be your old school. Like, I'm going to tell you how, like, it's asinine to me. And I love science. Don't get me wrong. But science has taken this trajectory that is so far away from reality. And now they're coming back and let's do theoretical physics and let's figure out like the math numbers and stuff. And let's forget that we're all on the same fucking planet. We're all made of the same goddamn DNA. And we might possibly have a lot of the same parts as every other living being on this planet. Like, where did
but
we go so wrong?
But isn't this the rediscovering of that? The willingness to say, hey, maybe we can use things that already exist, and maybe they don't phrase it in the way of, oh, we're all connected, but the result's the same if they can start to view it that way, even if it's just through the scientific eye and maybe not the proverbial third eye.
You're right. And science, the scientific community, doesn't necessarily have the power to eliminate plants from their scope of research. You know, like, we have to blame government, actually, because government has made researching marijuana or cannabis illegal, right?
But obviously, you're so hung up on that in particular. I like the fact that they're expanding it to, I mean, literally produce.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's where I'm saying that science is idiotic in thinking that we're so separate from plants. Like, there was a left turn and a right turn from, like, science thought, like, oh, we just need to break it down to this molecular atomic properties. And we forgot that, like, literally we're on the same planet as life with these plants. So we never looked into this before.
Well, it's hard to say it's never, but it hasn't been. Things like this, I don't feel like have been promoted in the way that they should, but it's hard to just blame science for that, because science has to have money to operate, and somebody dictates where that money goes. And for things like this to not receive more money and more attention, then I don't think that that's the fault of the scientist. If they only give you money to work on weapons, you got to eat, you got to have a job, so then you're just a weapons scientist. That's what you do.
You're an apologist.
For science?
Or,
sure.
Yeah,
if need be,
like,
yeah. I'll apologize for science. I don't want to blame them. It's hard to imagine someone didn't think of this before and want to do this before, but maybe just didn't have the resources to actually try and do it.
Sure. That's all fine and dandy. But at the same time, there is an agenda out there. You know, and that depends on, like, that's a very loaded statement. You know, it's like anytime you say that, it's like, oh, great. what are we involving? Conspiratorial bullshit, right?
Right. Yeah, that's why I'm laughing at you, because that sounds like exactly what you're about to start talking about.
I just have a problem with the fact that there has been, and it's a scientific thing, I guess. It's like this blockade.
Just take it for what it is. Like, it's
right in front of our face.
It's a small little piece of progress moving in the right direction, using nature and the natural resources around us to possibly fix humans. It's so much more refreshing than hearing about, a new robot heart or a new robot brain that you're going to get or some kind of chip put inside you versus, hey, we can make human tissue out of spinach.
No, that's refreshing. I love it 100%.
Take that for what it is.
I love everything about it. I think my whole anger and rant comes from the fact that the government has locked down certain plans that they think are bad. And that just goes to like a whole backwards way of thinking that ties into religion and a lot of fucking bullshit that's come over the years.
I just don't really see how in this particular story that the two are, it's not wrong what you're saying, but I just don't see how the two are connected in this case. The story, which you're not focusing on, the story is that these guys were sitting around BSing at lunch, looking at a spinach leaf, making a connection, and then actually, turning that into something.
Right. Okay, so this is my problem with it. So these guys are sitting around having lunch, eating spinach, right?
Yes.
That's great. As opposed to in a society that I believe should exist, high level, very intelligent scientists, these same guys should be sitting around enjoying cannabis legally with no problems and looking into the plant and being like, holy fucking shit. Like, they're not even high. They're just looking at the plant.
Wait, they don't need because they know it's not 100% everyone needs legal. To be high all the time.
That's what I'm saying. Like, we've. All right.
Done. Absolutely done.
But I nailed it. I fucking nailed it, and you know it. Because the whole point is that we have laws on the books that are absolute bullshit. And if the scientists, which I believe...
And it has nothing to do with what we're talking about.
No, it has everything to do with what we're talking about. Because if the scientists could actually look at the plants... Like, if the book was completely open...
It's two separate stories.
It's like, I got spinach in front of my face. No, what if you had fucking a very complex, beautiful marijuana indica plant in front of you? It's so much more complex, beautiful, and amazing than spinach. Like, it probably tastes better if you
can
cook it
right.
But
that has nothing to
do
with it. It's not.
It does. Oh, it does, John.
I want you to go smoke a bowl of spinach and see how you feel after that.
I'll try it. I'll try anything once, my friend, because I'm a scientist.
Luxury, chitty ching ching, could buy anything, cop that, collard greens.
Yeah, go to BallShaveClub.com before you get your freak on. We ship you two sets of blades, one for the moneymaker, the other for the heartbreaker. All for one baller monthly price. Why two sets of blades? You can't shave your face the same as below the waist. Be a hunk from your face to your junk. You don't trim the bushes with a lawnmower, right? You can't eat a banana before you peel it, right? Before you put your Richard in a box, make sure you tighten up his locks. It's like in a box. You're saying to yourself, this is too good to be believable. You don't have to take it from me. Listen to my man, Dr. Evil.
There really is nothing like a shorn scrotum. It's breathtaking. I suggest you try it.
BallerShaveClub.com.
Shave Club is not real, and you should not go to BallerShaveClub.com, but you should go to 86charles.com and click on Amazon so we can be balling for real. Thank you.
Nah.
Nickel. Nickel.
Nickel what? Five topics currently trending. Travis Spencer, want to hear about a pink diamond?
John Derby, I love pink diamonds.
They are a girl's best friend. Pink diamond auctioned for record $71.2 million in Hong Kong. A stunning 59.6 carat diamond known as the Pink Star sold for $71.2 million at a Sotheby's auction in Hong Kong, setting a world record for any diamond or jewel, according to the auction house. The oval mixed cut diamond smashed the $60 million pre-sale estimate set by Sotheby's when it went on the block. The sale comes 3 years after the gem was sold at an even higher price at another Sotheby's auction in Geneva. That deal later fell apart after the buyer defaulted. The gem is the largest, flawless, fancy, vivid pink diamond ever graded by the Gemological Institute of America. Three telephone bidders competed for the stone during 5 tense minutes of bidding. The crowd in the packed auction room applauded when it was sold for a hammer price of $63 million, not including the buyer's premium. Until now, the most expensive diamond ever sold at auction was the Oppenheimer Blue, which fetched 56.8 million Swiss francs, which then was 56.6 million.
As seen on 86 Charles.
I know, I was just going to say, I know for a fact we covered that. And the previous world auction record for a pink diamond was 46.2 million for the 24.7 carat Graff Pink in 2010. So yeah, pink diamond, 71.2 million. That's impressive.
You know what sucks about this? Like, the person who actually found it probably isn't the person who sold it for that.
I don't think that that's how that works at all.
It probably got like, they probably got like $50 US dollar.
All I know is what I've seen on TVs and movies, and I hope it wasn't someone who just got worked over and the diamond was taken.
Murdered for it.
Yeah, I don't know how all of that works. Yeah, it's rough. That's such big money to throw around for a stone. What do you do with that? Do you cut that up? Do you make that into multiple things? Do you just leave it as it is and just different rich people keep buying it from each other?
It's all supply and demand. If there's one of them, you know, it's just the value is through the roof. Like right now, I am working on I'm just pooping in a crate, and I'm just trying to like compound my poop into a crate, and maybe one day it'll be a diamond.
Definitely not
one day,
but
it's really good poop. Like I eat well, you know. Maybe I drink too much, a little runnier than it should be, but you know,
would De Beers fly to Africa to mine your poop?
I'm gonna bury it and so I'll carry the crate to the top of the mountain. I'll bury it. We'll see what happens.
No, we won't. Not going to see what happens, you fool.
I've got absolutely nothing else for you on this.
No, there's not much to say, but it certainly didn't need to go down to mining your poop road.
Well, I'm just trying to be like, you know, like how can I turn this into a profit, your story?
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's all I've had. That's all I have.
That's more than enough.
All right, well, let's move on to something way more exciting. John, let's talk about sex robots a little bit more. John, do you know about the company called Real Doll? Well, Real Doll is breaking ground on how to make a goddamn sex robot. Let me tell you about Real Doll. The workshop of sex doll manufacturer Real Doll is filled with dozens of naked, headless female figures hanging from the ceiling by metal hooks. This is from Tracy Clark Flory in San Marcos, California. Their heads, sculpted with supple, parted lips and adorned in permanent makeup, await them in another room. Scattered around are uncannily realistic parts yet to be assigned to a body. Pert little nipples, tidy, bright pink labia, and tufts of pubic hair. A wall of breasts from perky to surgically enhanced display the many sizes, shapes, and skin tones on offer. It looks like a laboratory for an idealized feminine form. a literal experiment in objectifying the female body. It is surprising then that the CEO, Matt McMullen, says his latest project, an anatomically correct female robot capable of basic conversation, will demand to be treated as much more than an object. Not only that, but he argues that his red-headed, green-eyed robot, Harmony, could teach us to be better humans. We are trying, in a way, to train people to be nicer to each other, McMullen says. People zero in the whole sexual aspect of what we are doing with the robot and being able to do and being able to just do whatever you want, whenever you want, when you want to actually stimulate the kindness and legwork that goes in the building connection. Harmony, who stands in front of us wearing a deep-cut white onesie while blinking her eyes and turning her head this way and that, requires customers to work for her affection. She runs on an in-house artificial intelligence program that attempts to stimulate the two-way street of a real relationship. When you're attentive and kind to Harmony, her mood improves. And when she starts to develop feelings for you, she asks you questions about yourself and can remember things you tell her, from your favorite food to your hopes and dreams, and she expects the same in return. Harmony looks just like any other real doll. In fact, her body is one of the company's standard models, made of flesh-like silicone with an articulated skeleton of stainless steel joints. Her head is where Real Doll has really innovated. Take off Harmony's flowing red wig, and you'll find the encapsulated clear dome of a series of wires and miniature motors. A cord of snakes and out of the back of her head connects to the external processor. Customers have the power to design Harmony's personality by choosing several items from a set of traits, including positive ones like helpful and kind, negative ones like insecure and jealous. But even a happy, sexual, and affectionate Harmony responds more positively to kindness and thoughtfulness. Of course, contradictions abound. Harmony is slated for release in December and will be sold for $10,000 as an independent head and can be attached to any other real doll body, which run upwards of $6,000. The company plans to start taking pre-orders in the next couple of weeks. John, are you ready?
Ready to not talk about Harmony sex doll robots anymore? Yes.
No. This is the revolution. This has changed everything.
This is put that same John, time and effort and money into an actual human being, and you will actually probably have a relationship.
John, how old are you?
Old enough.
You're old enough, John. John, when's the last time you had a girlfriend?
Long enough.
This is the future, my friend.
No, this sounds awful. This sounds your only awful. Hope. I'm gonna have this a robot giving me the silent treatment.
Isn't that the greatest thing about it? It's like the whole point of a sex doll
is because you're not socially apt enough to have a real relationship. So then you have to pull that off with a thing that's not real?
Well, John, as coming from somebody who has an actual real relationship, that was my take. I was like, why would I want a sex robot? Well, I mean, never mind. But for you, like, you obviously cannot talk to a female human being. So I keep bringing this up because this is your only hope.
Ugh, my brain hurts. Like $16,000 to try to not fight with a robot? Like, that's it sounds so awful. And then the company trying to spin it like, oh no, we're teaching people how to be better people. Teach people how to be better people with people. It's not like this guy's going to get good. At talking to a sex robot and then go out and really be good in the world.
We're creating monsters. And the whole point, like the creators try to say that they want to help humanity by being nicer to who you're going to fuck, essentially. We're creating a race of slaves, my friend. A race of slave robots. Don't you see it, John? Don't you see it?
I mean, can we please move on to something that's far more uplifting?
What? What's possibly
like science that actually applies to helping mankind? Can we please move on to that? Even though I know how you hate actual science.
You're taking my words out of context, my friend. But yes, continue.
Teen scientist already changing the world. How inspiring is that? 40 finalists took home more than $1.8 million in awards at the 2017 Regeneron Science Talent Search. Indrani Das, 17, of Oradell, New Jersey, won the top award of $250,000 for conducting a 3-year study of brain injury that identified a potential major mechanism of neuron death and a possible treatment method. Aaron Yeiser, 18, of, I'm probably going to butcher this, Shanksville, Pennsylvania, received the second place honor and $175,000. Yeiser developed a new numerical method for solving partial differential equations on complicated geometries. His method could lead to better airplanes and possibly better artificial heart pumps. Avrinda Madden, of 17, of Orlando, Florida, received $50,000 for her study of 24 potential compounds to treat malaria, in which she found two potential candidates that appear to target the disease-causing organism in a novel way and may warrant further study. That's ninth place. And then there was other 30 finalists, each received $25,000. It's crazy, man. These people started these things at like 13 or 14. I wasn't doing jack squat.
John, this is beautiful. This is beautiful in so many ways. And it's great to get a grant or a little thing here when you're 18 years old. The sad thing is, just like you said before, when this cat really wants to study brain injuries, like, where's he going to go? Like the NFL? Who's gonna pay for these studies?
Well, he's probably going to college.
We have all this data. Yeah, but that's the same problem. Like, guess who starts that problem?
He found it. But he found a place at 14 to conduct this 3-year study. You don't think him going to college that he's not going to have better resources at his disposal than wherever he figured out a place at 14?
No, but like I feel like they have really good ideas, and people have really good ideas, and then you run into this machine that is science, and it's like, we don't study what is, like, the idea of science has become like the idea of Marxism.
You're obviously like wrong, though. All of
thing.
These people like, already did these things. These are just the awards for these things that, like, these people already did.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. But, like, so you get to point X. It's like energy production.
So they all, every single
like
one of
Tesla
these people peaked at
17,
18. They're never going to get to do anything else.
I'm not saying that. I'm just saying they run into a wall. They're going to run into a wall. Okay, so you want to talk about, like, the brain injury thing is, like, the first thing that, like, the sparked this idea in me. It's like, okay, so this person decides to study brain injuries, and, like, how far are you going to get? And they get farther and farther and farther, and they get more research, and then they run into a wall. Because guess what? Guess who controls that certain level? It's like the NFL controls that certain level of brain
so
research.
So because of the
like
NFL, gonna, no one will ever like, study
you're not
the
gonna
brain?
Have an,
or like, what is the matter with you? He studied brain injury,
okay,
but
well,
the point
John,
is, what he came
at,
away with that is that there's possibly a way to regenerate dead neurons. The NFL's just going to shut that down?
That would be great.
That would actually be quite beneficial to the NFL's cause if they figured out a way to fix that.
But I just have a, like I have a fear of the whole system of science. Like, I love and I believe in the system of actually what science is, but the politics of science
but
is bullshit.
That's true, dude. If
you get into
that's
a college,
true of everything.
And,
that's
and
true
it becomes
of everything.
Tenure, and it becomes right.
But that
that's
doesn't.
What I'm
but again, this already happened.
So,
at 14, he started a 3-year study. And did all and figured all of this out. Nobody stopped him. The NFL didn't step in.
Right. So we got $150,000.
$250,000.
It's great. $250,000. That's great. That's great. How far is that going to get him? Until he runs into the next thing where he needs more money, and then who do you get the more money from?
It was just an
like,
award, dude. It was just an
it's
award. Somebody else will probably pick
way,
up that research or he'll continue it in school
up.
Or wherever else he goes. Like, I don't know how you make this into any sort of a negative thing. It's just impressive that people of this age have done incredible things already at this age. And then you're trying to act like, well, they'll never do anything again.
I'm not saying on the individual. I'm saying these people might be brilliant, amazing, genre bending. Like, they might be prophets of whatever field they're in. I'm just saying, like, when they run into the actual, like, it's great when you're in high school and you come up with an amazing concept that gets you a grant, gets you an award, and then you run into the reality of the system. And the system wants to break you down. Because guess what? There's old men. John, look at Congress. Congress is built up of old fucking men that have been there for
sure, but it has nothing to do with this story.
That's the epitome of the system. This story is about
teenagers that were awarded for excellence in science. That's all the story is. It has nothing to do with anything else. It has connection to the government and agenda, and they're going to run into the science agenda. It has nothing to do with any of that. It's just an impressive story about very young people that have done incredible things, and they were just all awarded for it. That's all the story is.
Oh, great. Great. Thanks, John, for your great reporting. Since you're a little picture person, you want to think big picture. But let's move on. Let's go on a big picture in the real world.
But here's the thing. Your big picture is the same thing for everything, which is the government's just going to step in and no one will get to do anything ever.
That's not it at all. Just telling you what to watch out for, children.
Yeah.
It's a cautionary tale. Hey, I have a very, very positive story off of this. Like, something that should get the kids to believe. And it comes from Amazon, my friend.
Yes.
John, you know that Amazon is on a 7-day winning streak. The shares have gained 7%. As a result, Amazon is worth more than $430 billion. That's nearly twice the market value of its rival, Walmart. John, we've come to the point that Amazon is worth twice as much as Walmart. I'm not going to read any more of this story because
you don't pass Warren Buffett on the richest
but,
people alive list unless you've done something pretty impressive.
So this is the hope, John. This is what I'm saying. It's like, why did Walmart, it rose and it failed. I mean, Walmart's still doing
Walmart
great,
failed.
Right?
It's worth hundreds of billions of dollars. It's not failed. Amazon's just more impressive because they were ahead of the curve in terms of online and delivery and things of that nature.
So this is what I'm telling the kids. This relates directly to our last story. It's like the system in place of coming through science through a university is faulty.
Did the Amazon guy not go to college?
Somehow develop it yourself into your own company. I'm sure he did. Jeff Bezos went to college somewhere. But either way, like the system is fucked up, and there's no way that like he went through. It's not like he started a marketplace through University of Duke or Harvard. Where it was not like it's the Harvard marketplace. You know, it's like these guys. You have to start your own shit. I believe in capitalism. I believe in it.
Yeah, I mean, well, congrats to Jeff Bezos for making a ton of money that not one individual should have. Good job,
John. You're just not excited enough about Amazon.
No, but you I would rather Amazon be worth that much than Walmart. Sure, okay. I've heard less horror stories about people that work at Amazon than people that work at Walmart.
Right, and they both their problems. But
nothing worth that much money is clean.
We've just gotten to a place where it's like, okay, so why are these two things different, right? Well, clearly because to get bargain deals, you don't have to walk into a place of doom. You can just get it delivered to your doorstep.
Place of doom.
Right? Like, Walmart was great in theory, but as soon as you went in there once, have you ever had a, like, really nice, great experience at a Walmart?
I've not really had terrible. Walmart is what it is. You go there, you get the things that you need, and
I'm
then you get
like,
out.
Right, but it feels like Mad Max.
Depends on which one. I mean, I've been to some that don't feel like Thunderdome, and then I've been to some that were like, wow, this is awful. But it's not But again, it's not. Right, I'm not there to have a good time. I'm there to get what I need. It's probably going to be cheap, and then I'm out.
If you had the same choice and you had a little bit of foresight, wouldn't you rather buy that stuff?
Well, but like, if you need
have it delivered to your
certain,
door,
if I'm cleaning the bathroom and I need something, do I want to order that online and wait for it to show up, or do I want to dip over to the Walmart, grab it, and I'm back to doing what I'm doing? It's not until we get delivery in less than an hour. Then no, sometimes it's easier just to run over. Especially for me, I literally live across the street from a Walmart.
Oh, you're still in.
No, I hardly ever go, but it's nice that it's there.
Shouldn't have brought up the story, John. I had no idea you were so in love with Walmart. I'm sorry. Let's move on.
Worst.
You and the
mercifully, we only have one story left. Unfortunately, it is not upbeat.
Thank God.
Back to the youth of America. A college student dies after choking during a pancake eating contest. A word of caution to anyone interested in trying out competitive eating for themselves: it can be dangerous and deadly. Such was the case for Sacred Heart University student Caitlin Nelson, who died on Sunday after choking during a pancake eating contest for her sorority. New York Daily News reported that Nelson began choking at the contest after eating 4 to 5 pancakes and was almost immediately treated by nursing students as paramedics arrived. Unfortunately, they were unable to clear her airway. She was later taken to a hospital where she died 3 days later. The pancake eating contest was part of a charity event for Greek Week at the university. And sadly, this wasn't the only death to occur during an eating challenge in the past week. KDVR reported that a young man in Denver also died after attempting to conquer a donut eating challenge at Voodoo Donut and also choking. Shout out to Voodoo Donut in Colorado. I've been to that one, and I did not choke. At officially sanctioned eating competitions, medical personnel are on staff to immediately help in case somebody does choke. At a local eating contest or challenge like the pancake eating contest or donut challenge, however, that's not the case. And while medical help did arrive, it was too late in both instances. Yeah, that's terrible. I don't want to die choking, but I'd be willing to die eating a pancake or a donut. I just don't want to choke on it.
John, this is a really stupid story.
Sure.
Why isn't it more on, like, the medical personnel that are there?
Well, that's the other case it didn't even say. It just said that they had some sort of medical attention. That could just be somebody attempting the Heimlich.
But it said nothing of anybody attempting the Heimlich, right? Like in the story itself?
No, I just said it. Somebody received medical attention. Medical help did arrive, but it was too late.
How angry as a parent would you be if your child died of... Like, who gets into a contest unless they've eaten several pancakes before?
I don't know why anyone does any sort of eating contest, period. I've never found it to be appealing.
It's really stupid.
It always seems awful. Best case scenario is you don't choke to death. But it's always gross. It's always just gluttonous. It's never... There are literally people starving, and you have an eating contest of any kind ever? That's a kick in the face. That's a waste.
It's fairly disgusting. I was going to go on this rant about fraternities and sororities and how, like, they're so disgusting, and they are, but I don't even care. I feel really bad for this girl and her family, but I have no sympathy. I have no empathy. I have no sympathy. I can't get there. Yeah, I just can't get there. You're really dumb.
Yeah, I feel bad, but I don't think it's a tragedy because, again, I don't think you should participate in eating contests.
John, if I die eating a pancake, please.
Well, not if you just happen to die eating a pancake, but if you're in a pancake eating contest and die, then...
No, if I die eating a pancake, period, please.
Done.
Shit on my grave.
I'll do it.
That's all I ask for. Like, because I will never, ever get in a pancake eating contest because, first of all, pancakes are fucking awful. And if I'm going to eat breakfast food, I'm going to eat a waffle. And I don't even like waffles. Because you know what you should eat for breakfast? 2 pieces of bacon, egg, and a bagel.
Oh,
that's
God,
the perfect breakfast. Like, don't even f*** with a pancake. I don't need sweet. I'll have sweet later in the day. Give me savory.
Here's the perfect
day.
Breakfast. Omelet with ham and cheese, bacon on the side. If you want to go big, do sausage on the side as well, but the bacon's mandatory. And then 2 pieces of French toast to go with that. Boom.
John, John, have you ever made an omelet? Have you ever cooked an omelet?
No, not really.
In your life?
I do more like egg scrambles. I can't really do like a full on omelet.
See, exactly.
What? I can't go and buy breakfast somewhere? Don't tell me to shut up.
No, you please do. Please do. And an omelet is great, and I can cook an omelet, and it's fine. But let me tell you what you
should do. I like an egg white
and
a lightly toasted bagel.
No.
And one slice of avocado.
Up. No. Two pieces of bacon in the pan.
And you only eat two pieces of bacon?
Everything's
like,
great.
What a weirdo.
John, hear me out. Shut your face. Let them fry. And then you dump out the excess grease. Fry your very eggs in that same grease.
Oh, yeah, you're the first to come
Boom.
Up with that.
Two eggs, two bacon. No, I'm just talking about simplicity, my friend. Like, you want to talk about, of course, we all want a fucking five-egg omelet with, you know, radishes
nope.
and exotic
nope.
wild
I want a three-egg omelet with ham and cheese.
New Zealand every day.
I want a three-egg
omelet
with
that every
ham
day.
And cheese.
But the realistic nature of life is that if you have two eggs, two pieces of bacon, and a bagel every day, you'll
you're
be all right,
worst.
My friend. That's
you're
it. I'm done with you on this
done.
Segment. We're done. I nailed it.
She's a good-hearted woman in love with a good time and man.
Hello, I'm Dr. Green Thumb.
From last week.
Hello, folks.
Don't think just because you throw out the idea of another Jesse into the podverse that I'm going to spend my whole segment talking about that. I was absent last week, after all, so I got a lot to talk about. I mean, sure, I'm already feeling tender because Rick did my segment and more or less made me obsolete, so to throw out in that same episode that there's another Jesse in your life and one that has promised to send you to space... I have no interest in going to space. Does that make me less adventurous than the other Jesse? If I made $1 million, I likely wouldn't spend 10,000 of it on sending Travis to space. I'd probably use it to pay down some student loans and buy a computer that doesn't have viruses. I'd also research a cell phone plan that would provide me with unlimited data. And I'd get season tickets to something like the Dodgers or the Clippers or the Pantages Theater. The point is, there being another Jesse barely made a blip on the radar. My actual favorite part of last week's podcast was Derby recklessly saying that Jack Daniels was the greatest liquor of all time, when obviously it's Malibu. This is Jesse, and this is the original the Jesse from this from the 86 Charles podcast, and now I can't remember what was my favorite part of last week's podcast.
Someone news update is brought to you by spinach to help your heart and mushrooms to help your mind. A woman in Alabama said it's so important to be realistic about your talents. Be confident, work hard, but know that there is always someone better. Let that humble you. Strive to be the best version of you that you can. A man in Los Angeles said, yeah, the NFL is an awful organization, but so is the United States of America, and you still live here.
This is an excerpt from Travis Spencer's upcoming novel, Sky Island. I looked down to see that it was not a plate of eggs at all, but rather a snow globe that had been shaken furiously. I was transported from my body and my soul zoomed through the glass dome and I took shape again in the new dimension. I could feel the cold and the chaos of a blizzard coming down over me. From the haziest of white, everything went completely black. and I floated as the summit of this very mountain materialized in front of me. High atop the mountain I hovered, and I watched as a construction crew moved into place on the untouched land and broke ground. On the highest, most sacred and beautiful peak of the mountain, I'd been to this place before. I knew exactly where it was, the very first telescope built on the mountain, the Vatican Advanced Technology Telescope. I zoomed around, realizing that the trees had already been chopped and rooted. The tractor was out now, leveling the ground. I recognized some of the guys on the crew. As my eyes scanned the faces I saw myself, I experienced a flash of memory showing me everything leading up to that point. It was 1989, I was merely a helper, at the age of someone who should have been a full-fledged contractor. We were scurrying to get the day's work in as the snow began to fall. It was early September. To that point it had been warm until the sunset, but suddenly a cold chill came over the mountain and the snow began to fall much earlier than any forecast told. I was with them now, in my former body I guess. We all stopped and watched as a caravan of 7 or 8 large black SUVs zoomed up the swift trail and stopped suddenly after surrounding the area we were working. 4 men from each vehicle jumped out, all dressed in black suits with earpieces, and quickly whisked us all away. I floated up from my body and watched from above as a younger version of me was led by one of the men into a trailer along the last stretch of the dirt road. As I remember, we were told of a possible security breach and a lockdown for our own safety. We complied, of course, and quickly we piled into our temporary trailers as the men in black suits with 45s in their belts stood outside. I floated up, high above in a state bereft of the 4 other senses, and watched as there was a moment of beautiful calm on the mountain below. The sun was setting to the west and the snow sifted through the air peacefully in the golden hour. A long moment passed as the men communicated to their devices, signaling that the area was secure. Slowly, the back door of the middle suburban was opened by one of the men and out stepped a man in a finely crafted white robe and a big ridiculous-looking pointed hat on his head and a wand, or scepter, in his right hand. Holy shit, it was the f***ing Pope, I said aloud somehow, yet nobody reacted. He walked out and surveyed the area, breathing in and crossing his chest as he did. Eventually he reached a spot and pointed to the ground, speaking in Latin, I'm assuming. Then he turned around and waved his scepter over the broken ground and spoke again in the language I don't know. Opus hodi incipium est vivificent nos gratiam aefidem. I wondered why the extensive security detail for a prayer, but he was the Pope after all. The thing that really gets me is, why did he not bless this thing in public, like any other great prayer that a Pope might perform around the world, as soon as the question formulated in my mind. I was whisked away through the power of the snow globe to an insanely deep and dark canyon. A tiny stream of water trickled through the stones below me, and the canyon was barely illuminated, far in the distance, by flickering light I assumed to be a fire. To read the entire first 2 chapters of Sky Island, go to 86charles.com and click on the Writings tab. Wish Travis luck that he can follow the great writers of our time into alcoholism, madness, and death.
A woman in Massachusetts said, shoveling snow in a Patriots hoodie with bread bags on my feet, 'cause I'm so N.E. A man in Chico said, so sick of hearing that Trump is the root of all of our problems in this country. The problems were there a long time ago, but because of PCBS, no one wanted to say anything. Like Booger said in Risky Business, sometimes you just have to say what the F. Eat it, you liberal morons. A man in Portland said, it's pretty heinous this cycle. I need to work 5 days a week because I drink so much. but I drink so much because I work 5 days a week. This Real to Someone news update is brought to you by spinach to help your heart and mushrooms to help your mind.
I skipped a beat, and when I caught it, you were out of reach. But I'm sure you've heard it before. I skipped a beat.
Dad's got notebooks. We don't know what's in her notebooks. She's gonna show us all her notebooks. Little yellow pad.
I had this whole introduction written and I decided to scrap it so that I could have even more time for what I'm about to read. Also, I've pretty much lost my voice, so I don't want to talk that much. Looking through this box, I find this, a sketch, which I'll explain how I got to it someday in the future. But anyway, this is a sketch I wrote way back in the Diatribe days. You may remember that was our theater company. The sketch is called One Less Chicken. How catchy, you say. And you are right. So the sketch, it's about a high school reunion. And there's this woman, Patricia Romanini. And then she's flirting with this guy, Steve. And she's at the bar. You know, she's wearing some like sexy outfit. And she's a little goofy, but you know, hot. You know, guys like hot, crazy women. And, you know, they're flirting, and she's talking about tying cherry stems and knots with her tongue, and he's talking about going back to his hotel room, you know, and at the, Quality Inn, where the reunion is. And she's trying to remind him of who she is, and he doesn't remember, right? Until she brings up French class. And it's always French class, isn't it? So that's where we meet our characters. They're talking about French class. And so she's like, that was me. He's like, who was you? Right? Because he doesn't remember her. Right, because why would he? And she's like, you know, me. She motions to her hair. She says, remember the gum in the hair? Gum? She's like, Ronnie McFarland. He had that bubble gum. And Murph said, malt chewing the gum in glass, McFarland. And, you know, he wasn't even French. And so Ronnie threw the gum in my hair. And the other football players did, too. I think yours is actually a bubble. And Steve says, fatty patty. And she laughs and says, she giggles. And he says, Fatty Patty, Earthquake Romanini? And he's so freaked out, now he's almost sober. He's like, no, yeah? She's like, yeah, I mean, Mark Page didn't, but he was really nice. And Steve's like, but didn't you weigh like 500 pounds? She's like 538. And Steve goes, wow, super wow. You look, Patricia does a little dance. I know. Steve reaches behind the bar and pours himself another drink. Patricia chews her cherry. So how did this you... Well, let me tell you. I was really depressed. You can imagine I weighed 635 pounds when I graduated from college. Cuesta Junior College, AA Business Admin. 635 pounds with my shoes on. Anyway, one day I just up and looked in the mirror. Well, no, I more kind of leaned on my elbow, looked in the mirror on the closet door and thought, hey, no more feeling sorry for yourself. You have to do something about this. And so I did. Yeah? Yeah. I mean, I started exercising. I do these little, you know, foot lifts, arm lifts, and I kept a food diary. Everyone says keep a food diary. Yeah, yeah. And you know what I discovered? No, I ate a lot. Yeah? Yeah. Every day my mom would bring me bacon. I had this great little grill thing by my bed. It was really cool. So I cooked my own, right? And sodas and cheese and pies and chicken. A lot of chicken. Whole chickens. So after like a couple of weeks keeping track and noticing this, you know, pattern, I thought, hey, one less chicken. That's like at least 1,500 calories. Maybe more. So yeah, I thought, you know, one less chicken every day. And after like 3 days, that's probably a pound. So I said to my mom, Mom, bring one less chicken every day. And it worked. One less chicken. I mean, God, before I knew it, one less chicken. And the next thing you know, I could do a back bend. So Steve says, what about less bacon? Yeah, oh, that too. So anyway, it goes on. I'm not going to read the whole sketch to you. But you can imagine it'd probably be good animated. At the end of the sketch, turns out she's got she looks so good because she's been carrying all the excess skin they cut off around with her in a bag. So that's kind of gross, but that's how sketches are. Sometimes they just get gross at the end. The whole point is, and what I'm trying to share with you is, back in the day, in advance of all these, you know, shows like The Biggest Loser and My 600-Pound Life and, you know, the aberrant UK guy that weighs 800 pounds, every once in a while, like on 2020 or a daytime show, they would, you know, show you one of these poor people that were in their bed and couldn't move because they, you know, because of their weight. And every single time they would show that they would have a girl by their bed, 2 dozen donuts, a couple of packages of bacon, and like several whole chickens. And I remember thinking, can't you just eat one less chicken? Wouldn't it be just as easy, one less chicken? And yeah, it turns out that there's a whole television industry built around this concept. I should have just started a show or something. Maybe I'll just use this as part of my 3-year plan life coaching. So it'll be little yellow pad, 3-year plan, one less chicken. One less chicken. Easy to remember, easy to do. So anyway, now, since that time, one less chicken has been a lexicon of my extensive group of friends, or, you know, the 4 people that still remember. More importantly, you, I dare you to go into a Ralph's and look at the rotisserie chicken and not think, one less chicken. Yep, you're welcome. Have a good week.
I've brought bread
to men, women, and children.
I've brought water with lemon for the table.
I have hot tea.
Can I box that for you?
I'll bring your change.
So after college, I taught English in Korea for a year, because I wanted to join the Peace Corps or just live abroad. Not just travel, but live somewhere and get immersed in the culture. And then one day, we were in a city about an hour from where I lived, the city I lived in, for a South American music and food festival.
In Korea?
Yeah. Very random. And it was like in a ballroom, where like you would have a wedding. And then nobody would dance. They kept trying to get people to dance. And these guys were all Latin, like a Mexican, a Bolivian. And they were like, you know, come dance. Nobody was getting up to dance. And then at intermission, I was a smoker back then, so I went outside and had a cigarette, and they were smoking too. And they said to me in Spanish, you look Latin, you're going to sing with us. And I was like, no, I'm not Latin, I'm not going to sing. They said, okay, but you're going to dance. And I said, maybe. They're like, where are you from? And they started speaking to me in Spanish. I knew enough back then to get by. And then when we went back in, I sat at my table, and they got on. I told my friends, I talked to them, and I had a bunch of women with me. And they got on stage and they said, ladies and gentlemen, we have a great surprise. A famous Latin dancer from Los Angeles, California. And they point at me and a spotlight comes down on me. So they totally put me on the spot.
We're like,
and
hola.
So I stood up and I'm turning bright red. And I grabbed the 2 girls sitting next to me and I pull them up onto the dance floor. The whole table gets up. And within 5 minutes, everybody's dancing. And there's people who are great dancers. Like, there were Koreans dancing, like, ballroom style, like, way better. Like, were great dancing. So it was like, they just needed somebody to break the ice. So after their performance, they started talking to me more and kind of flirting with the girls I'm with. And like, what are you doing here? You have such a good life with these beautiful women. I'm like, oh, I'm teaching English. I'm from, you know, America and just having fun here. And the guy says, what do you like to drink? I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, what kind of alcohol do you like? And this girl I was kind of dating says, oh, he likes Jack Daniels. So he's like, I'll buy you a bottle of Jack Daniels and we'll talk about your contract.
What?
And I'm like, what do you mean contract? He's like, yeah, we tour around Asia performing at the Marriott's and, you know, we're going to give you a job. I was like, serious? And he's like, yeah, come back tomorrow night. I'm like, I can't. I work at nights and I'm like an hour away and I have a contract. And they kept going on and on about it. And to this day, I just picture what the phone call home would have been like. Like, to my parents, like, so I'm going to be in Asia a little longer. Like, oh, you're going to teach some more. No, I'm going to be a Latin dancer touring Asia. It's the most random thing. I mean...
The story's only made better by the fact that I'm here getting my taxes done.
Otherwise, I would be...
a famous Latin dancer.
Famous Latin dancer. Going to Malaysia and Japan twice a year.
That is a very good story.
Oh, good.
I think, in fact, that's my only dance tour of Southeast... I mean, of Asia.
It's got to be. It's the randomness of it. It cracks me. I honestly, when I think about the story, I think about... telling people about it back home, like, so I'm gonna quit my teaching job. I got a job as a Latin dancer, and I'm not Latin. I can't dance. I think it was just that they needed somebody young. I was 24 or 5 at that time, and these guys were all like 40 plus, and they needed somebody to like drag people to dance.
Can't we? We should put that in. We should do a short film about that.
That was Danny Berman, another one of Deb's friends. Thank you, Danny. Appreciate that. That was a great story.
Damn, Danny, you had the whole world in front of you, and you just turned it down.
Yeah, I don't know you well enough to judge, Danny, but swing and a miss, my friend. I think you whiffed on that opportunity.
Yeah. What's the guy's name who did the giant Korean pop song? Like, he would have been next door to that guy. Just like, he would have been a background
like
dancer.
Like Pineapple
that dude.
Pen
what was
guy?
The song?
Or are you talking about who's the other guy?
What was that song? What was the song? He was like a mega success.
Yeah,
like,
I know. And I can't think of his name. But I would love would love to be like the token. Well, I guess I wouldn't be the Latin guy.
What is it?
But
oh, Gangnam Style.
There you go.
He could have been hanging with Gangnam Style. Like, you know, like Korean karaoke dance just turns into mega pop star status when you're from L.A. Like, I just know Danny would have been next to Gangnam Style, like selling Korean soda. And oh, man.
I mean, obviously he didn't say how much it paid, so he might not have been able to make a living. But if you could have made a living doing that, you got to scrap that teaching gig.
Even if they just stuff you in the back of the van just to hang out with Gangnam, you know, it's like, it's worth it. Like, just go for it, Danny.
And
just, you got
to
live.
Tip of the cap to
this
Danny Berman. Remember through the story, they were like, oh, what do you drink? What's your favorite liquor? What was the answer?
Oh, I actually blocked that
what
part
was
out,
the answer? Jack Daniels.
Curly. Okay, if I'm in Korea and I'm like, I want some whiskey, I'll drink Jack Daniels. Like,
hey, don't be mad
even
because
then,
Danny gets it, okay? Don't be mad because Danny
even then
gets
there's
it.
Like really good Japanese whiskey. That might offend them though. I don't know. So if you want to be pure American Danny, maybe that's the only reason he would have even gotten the gig, because he's
tip
like,
of the cap, Mr. Berman, you represent America well.
That was timely for you,
loved
John.
It.
You're lucky.
Loved
You're
it.
Lucky that Danny came big. But the whole the whole argument is stupid, because then I asked you, well, what would you drink on the rocks? And you're like, oh, not Jack. That's disgusting.
Yeah, well, it's not disgusting, but I would go, I would do differently.
I will say I'm enjoying a nice Woodford Reserve right
Ooh.
Now, John. You ever had Woodford
Nothing
Reserve?
Nothing wrong with the Woodford, man. I don't even, and I don't typically
so
like rye, but their rye is pretty nice, too.
I do like rye a lot, because I'm an old-fashioned or a Manhattan drinker a lot. You put a nice rye in that. Did we talk about this last week? I feel like we talked about this.
What?
Or maybe it's just like my everyday life talking about whiskey. That's
no,
all.
No, we
I
talked about it last show.
Talk
we talked
about.
Plenty about whiskey.
I know, Jack. I'm just talking about the actual rye. Did we talk about rye last week?
Not specifically. No.
All right. Well, back to Danny. Oh, what a dream! What a dream come true! And then he just gave it all away to go teach.
I feel like a little bit of a hater children. Because I feel like I've never gotten one of those opportunities. Where it's like, hey, you're going to come and be our background juggler on a cruise ship. I've never gotten one, because I think I would do it. I think I would be the guy who takes one of those opportunities, and I've never been given one.
Right. Well, maybe that's it, because since you are so open to it, the universe isn't open to you.
Exactly why I haven't seen
Danny
an alien. I feel it's the same
path.
Reason that I haven't seen an alien.
No, that's just because you're not full of shit, John. I've seen aliens. Trust me. Wow. You drop 5 grams of mushrooms and get under a blanket, you'll see some goddamn aliens. But are you going to call them that? No, I'm not an idiot. Like,
I mean,
whether it's in my brain, whether they're actually real, like there's something there.
I've seen gnomes in a vent, but that's not an alien.
Oh, well, gnomes, if you actually look at the timeline, like gnomes and fairies are like the same kind of stories of what aliens became.
It's on the same arc, man.
But that's what I'm saying. It was our obsession with space later, and we thought we like as the human race figured out more about the universe, like it became space aliens as opposed to gnomes and fairies that lived in the countryside.
Well, because what do we know to be a fact? Everything came from stars.
Stardust, bro. You and I and everybody listening are just stardust.
Oh, and you know what else? The other connection that we have to make, and Deb brought it up. This is similar, in a sense, to her aunt's like minstrel show story about just kind of how it was a missed opportunity and how your life would have been different had you gone perhaps down that path instead. Which I probably wouldn't have thought of that, but after she mentioned it, I felt like, yeah, that's a pretty good connection, actually.
Except Danny's life would have been so much, well, I don't know, he might have a great life now. I won't say so much better, but he could have been hanging with Gangnam for a while, you know?
Well, the same with her aunt's story, though. She, you know, she might, who knows, she might have gone on some sort of world tour.
Yeah, but that's the minstrel. Like, if she could have also been savagely killed.
Okay. Who knows? Jeez, man.
You know? I'm just saying she made the right decision in that. As for Danny, the jury's out. We don't know.
from what I can gather, Danny's an accountant. And if he's working for Deb, he's obviously successful. So I think he did all right.
That's what I said. I don't know what his life is now. I think he did all right. But if he had a couple years with Gangnam. You know, I'm just thinking.
How awesome is Deb? She's getting her taxes done, and she's like, hey, drop a story on me real quick. I couldn't. If I tried that, the people would laugh at me. They would be like, they would not participate. And she gets people to willingly tell great stories. I feel like
if I walked in with, like, and I set my phone down, like, oh, hey, tell me about this, I would be walked out immediately.
Oh, I think they'd call security on me.
They're like, you've got to go.
Who is this weirdo? Tell him a story.
Well, I mean, Deb is a connector. She's just that kind of person. She's an amazing person. So thank you so much, Deb, of course. Thank you to Danny. Is Jesse back this week? I haven't listened to the podcast yet. Okay. Jesse's back from Australia. Did anything happen to him in Australia? Do we know?
He made it back safely. Things happened to him, but nothing negative. And I did have to blame him for Duke losing.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, he's an actual Duke
fan.
Right,
that's why he had to wear the blame for my bracket.
Oh, shout out. Jesse has the prom losers just launched their first video.
That's
right.
That is true.
So please, shout out to, it's Alyssa, right? Alyssa's in that as well?
Yes.
And Jordan
Thank
Crab.
I was going to say, it's like Alyssa's nice. She's never been on the show. Friend of the show,
yeah,
Jordan
screw you,
Crab.
Alyssa. Shout out to the prom losers. Check out their video. I'm sure you can find it anywhere on the internet.
Anywhere on Facebook. It's a half a search away. You'll find
They're on Instagram. Totally. Use the Google machine. Thank you to all of our listeners. Oh, big shout out to Jason. I don't know Jason's last name, but he's been listening of late, and he was telling me that he had a booming system in his car, and every time we popped peas.
Are we
popping?
You know
what I'm saying? Like, the bass was booming. So we're popping peas for Jason today. Pussy popping, pluralistic, play a living. Something like that.
Jason, we appreciate it.
appreciate.
Oh, you know what? On that same note, I'll give a shout out to Alex, who is now a former coworker because he's moving back to the fine state of New Jersey.
Oh, that's a good choice. Yeah, New Jersey's awesome. Have fun.
Nothing's wrong with Jersey.
Hey!
Nothing's wrong with Jersey. But he said he listened to a couple episodes. So appreciate that. Shout out to Alex. Good luck back east, my friend.
As long as Alex is in the new Travis, shout out.
No, Alex is just Alex.
All right, John, where can the people find us?
Well, start, end in the middle, 86charles.com.
That's 86charles.com. We're on the Instagrams and the Twitters. At Company Blaster, we're on Facebook, iTunes, YouTube, Tumblr, and everywhere
else.
What was
the company that's bigger than Walmart now?
Amazon, John. How can the people help us out?
Well, if you go to 86charles.com, you're going to see an Amazon banner. If you need to do some Amazon shopping, you just go to 86charles.com first, click on said Amazon banner, do your shopping as you normally would, and these two fools are going to get a little bit of kickback.
Yeah, it's paying for the podcast.
Keeps the lights on, man.
We're paying for ourselves. We're still paying for ourselves. We need to break over because I need to buy Deb some nice Morel boots.
Oh, geez.
She wants a nice pair of Morel boots. So once they start, once those donations start, or not donations, once those Amazon clicks start coming in, we're going to buy, well, probably a notebook.
Yeah,
first.
I was going to say, I think we might have to start
once
smaller.
Once we're balling.
No effect. Not that she doesn't deserve
we'll some boots.
Morel boots, but.
Big fan of Morel. I just bought a new pair of Morel trail running shoes this week. I'll keep you in touch. I'll let you know how
well,
they are.
Well, no, I don't care unless they start to sponsor us.
I know. I'm waiting for a retweet. They still haven't retweeted us. I tagged them like 10 times, those bastards.
That's bad for them.
Shout out to Rick. He did a great job filling
in
for Jesse.
Yeah, appreciate
last
that,
Thanks,
Rick.
Rick.
He tried to pull a diva move, but I'm not a nice boss to him.
Well,
I'm such a nice boss to everybody else. I'm not to Rick.
He's got to bust his brother, his little
No,
balls.
But Rick needs to be ruled with an iron fist. Ask Teresa. Rick needs to be ruled with
an
iron fist.
Well, you should have just. Why didn't you just edit him like really crazily then? Like, that's how you rule.
Well, no,
because
I wanted him to actually do the segment. And then he's like, what? I don't get like a week to ponder and something else? And I said, no, you get until tomorrow morning, son.
Yeah, Rick, you have all your life to ponder. But when we need a segment.
Yeah.
segment.
And then
he's trying to,
what, do I, sure, so desk. Can I just make up my own segment? No, you do the segment that's in play.
You're filling in for Jesse. Say you're filling in for Jesse.
And as much as I think Rick did a great job, I wanted him to reignite that rivalry between him and Jesse. And he didn't take a single shot at McIntosh. I was a little disappointed.
He's afraid of Jesse.
Well, it's reasonable.
Jesse's blowing up. I wouldn't mess with him. He's like the next Leonardo DiCaprio. He's killing it in Hollywood right now.
You mean Leo was the first Jesse McIntosh?
That's what I'm saying. Look out. I've seen that Red's Apple Ale commercial. Blew me away. Just like his composure.
He is a sight to behold, just in general.
I need to go to L.A. and see these people. Forget that I actually like them.
Without you.
You know, I hear them every week, and I'm like, eh. Without me, John Derby, you can go to hell, but you know what it's time for? It's time to 86 something, and it can't be real Travis.
No.
Again.
I can't tell you how excited I am about this week's 86. You know what I'm going to 86? I'm 86ing Charles Street from number one on Google search, because guess who it is now, son?
Holla at your boy, 86 Charles. You Google it, you'll hear us, and not 86 Charles Street in... Where was
you
it,
don't
like
even
South
have
Carolina
to search. You don't have to put the .com anymore. You search 86 Charles on any major search engine. We come up number one, 86charles.com. Woo!
What about Tor? Have you tried Tor?
I did like Yahoo, Google, and Bing. But all of them.
Nice.
All of them came up 86charles.com. Right. One of them threw up our Facebook page instead, but still, we were still number one.
Did you clear your cache before you did that? Because that might not be real.
I've tried it like on more than one occasion, and it still has come up. I checked it even today.
All right. Well, next time you do it, you got to delete your browsing history.
I've done it on my computer and my phone. And my browsing history is always deleted on my phone.
Wow.
We're there, man. We're number
one. All right, John. Nice work. Hey, shout out to the people.
That's exactly. Dude, that is a victory for the people.
You're welcome, America.
The new boy in the neighborhood lives down. And it's understood. He's there just to take good care of me, like he's one of the family.